5 years ago, I set out on the most epic adventure of my life, riding a bike to the South Pole. This is my story.
Two of the questions I get asked a lot are, how much did the expedition cost and how did I pay for it? In this episode, I'm going to answer those two questions. I left my home on November 15th and had a short layover in Santiago on the 16th. Finally arrived in Punta Arenas on the 17th.
Okay, well, I made it to Punta Arenas, so I guess this is the official beginning of my expedition.
Getting to Antarctica has never been easy.
Where did you start, number two?
I started in Hercules Inlet. It's on the coast of Antarctica.
Number one, just for clarity, you flew to Antarctica and then started biking when you got to the coast of Antarctica?
That's correct, all the way down.
Number two, how did you end up on Antarctica?
Yeah, I flew from Chile down to Antarctica.
Number three?
I flew from Chile, Punta Arenas. With a military plane?
That sounded really sexual. I'm sorry.
Which
part? Military plane or Punta?
No, the Punta. Oh,
okay, yeah. Okay.
Back in the heroic age of Antarctic exploration, in order to get through the icy Southern Ocean, explorers like Shackleton, Scott, and Amundsen would sail through the summer when there is less ice and arrive at Antarctica at the end of summer. And then they would have to establish a camp and endure a dark winter where the sun would not rise for 4 months before they could actually start across the continent to the South Pole. I had it much easier. After arriving in Punta Arenas, I would wait for a flight that would take me to a base camp on Union Glacier. But flights to Antarctica can only be done when the weather conditions are right. I was scheduled to fly out a few days after arriving in Punta Arenas, but the weather had been bad, and they hadn't been able to fly, and the base camp at Union Glacier was running out of supplies. So first they would need to fly a resupply mission, and then I would be able to fly. And so I was in Punta Arenas with nothing to do but explore the area on foot, and to check in each day to see if the weather had cleared enough to allow flights.
On all the street corners there seems to be a thing of having your dog just lay on the ground, sleeping, and maybe that's why there's no penguins in this area. It's if there were any penguins, they'd all have been eaten by dogs.
I love Punta Arenas. One of the first things I decided to do was walk down to the Straits of Magellan. While walking along the beaches, I came across this, the remains of a frigate called the Lord Lonsdale. Exactly how and why she ended up here is a bit of a mystery. I found this on the Atlas Obscura website. The Lord Lonsdale started its final journey a world away in Hamburg, Germany in 1909. The 10-year-old ship was set to sail all the way to Mazatlan on the west coast of Mexico. With the Panama Canal still under construction, that meant a trip through the Straits of Magellan, which separates mainland Chile from Tierra del Fuego. While stopped over in the Stanley Harbor in the Falkland Islands, the ship caught fire. With the blaze out of control, they did the only thing they could. They sank the ship. Stanley Harbor is 560 miles away from Punta Arenas. They may have had plans to move it to their warehouse in Puerto Natales to use it for storage, a feat requiring hundreds of miles of towing through the straits. But it only got moved to Punta Arenas before they literally abandoned ship. The area along the Straits of Magellan seems strange to me. Along the beaches were great bike paths and some public exercise equipment. But there was nobody using them. I had the beaches and bike paths all to myself, but I didn't have my bike yet.
And now if my bike arrives, I think my bike should be, if everything's going the way they were saying it would, should be here tomorrow, and then I can start getting everything packed up and ready to go. There's a few things that didn't fit very well in my suitcase, so I took those and threw them out, and I'll have to just see if I can't buy replacement parts for those here.
November 11th, 2013. The hostel provides breakfast, which I eat at 8 a.m. each day. Today, at 7:15, I got a call saying my bike was here and they would meet me at 8:15 to go see it. I sneaked into the kitchen and ate a little, then went down to the ALE office and then to the warehouse where the bike is. I was happy to find everything in good shape. They built a box that kept the bike assembled and had just the bike in it, Everything else was in a bunch of small boxes. The bad news is there is a $3,000 bill I have to pay for getting everything through customs and transported to Punta Arenas. I'm worried about running out of cash. Somehow, eventually, I need funds to be used to pay the loan instead of the extra costs. When I sent my bike to Antarctica, I had very explicit instructions on how to get the bike there without having to pay customs. And one of the things that was very important is that the bike be shipped to Antarctica, not to somewhere in Chile. And so I was very careful in how I labeled everything and put things together to try to make sure that my bike and all my expedition gear was being shipped to Antarctica. But the problem was is that my box was too big to be able to fit in the plane that would go from Santiago down to Punta Arenas, because the bike was just too big. So when DHL put together the paperwork for the shipment, they made the mistake of shipping it to Santiago, where then it would be taken off the plane and put in trucks and driven through Argentina and down to Punta Arenas. And because they put Santiago as a destination along the route, that meant that Chile decided that my bike was being imported into Chile and I had to pay customs for it. And so this was a pretty difficult thing for me. Any kind of expedition to the South Pole is pretty expensive, and the majority of that expense goes to a company called Antarctic Logistics and Expeditions. They provide all the logistics and the flights to and from Antarctica. They provide the support for me to be able to call in and tell where I am. And they also would do the drops of the food supplies that I would need along the way. So that's where most of the expense goes. So I said there were two questions I was going to answer. How much did this cost? And how did I pay for it? And I'm going to kind of mix those two questions together and answer both questions at the same time. So the cost, I didn't figure out an exact number, and I could probably go through and get exactly how much I spent on everything. But I think that's not really important because the numbers are big enough. Just the generalities of the numbers will be fine. So before this whole thing happened, I was a computer programmer, and I made pretty good money as a computer programmer. I was fortunate to have gotten into WordPerfect early on, and so I ended up with stock options that I was able to cash in for a fair amount of money, and so I did well with the stock options and with being paid well. And so I was completely out of debt, and I had a fair amount of money saved away. And then I opened up a bike shop, and to do the bike shop, I ended up taking all the savings I had, and I spent all of that on inventory and running the bike shop. And then I ended up borrowing a lot of money against my house to be able to keep the bike store running. And so by the time I was doing the South Pole expedition, I was out of money. I had been living for 7 years with no income, and living off of the money I had saved up before I opened the bike shop and the loan that I took out against my house. And so when it came time to do the expedition, I didn't have any money. I'd spent everything. I was basically, you know, I didn't have any cash in the bank. I had loans, and I was getting further and further in debt the longer I had my bike store open. So initially my plan for how to pay for the expedition was I tried to do a Kickstarter project. I set up Kickstarter to be able to do a movie of the expedition. And initially I had planned to have more support, be able to have people there helping me film it, but it turned out that I didn't come anywhere close to getting the amount of money that it would need to get from Kickstarter. And the way Kickstarter works, if you don't hit your goal, you don't get anything. So I didn't get any money from Kickstarter. I did do a GoFundMe account, and I got a little bit of money from GoFundMe that helped, but But for the most part, the money I got, I ended up having to take a loan out to get the money I needed to do this. So I took a loan for, I took out a loan for $80,000, and I spent all of that. I spent the full $80,000. Most of that went to ALE, and then I spent the rest of it on equipment and things I would need and my flights and stuff. And I spent all the $80,000 plus. I spent some more than that. I spent all the money that I did get from donations, and I, by the time I was in Punta Arenas, I basically was out of money. And so when I got that $3,000 bill for my bike, because it got counted as being imported, my bike and all my equipment got counted as being imported into Chile. And so that was extremely difficult for me, because I had to figure out how to pay for that, and I had to pay for my flight back home. And so I was just barely able to cover all those costs. I did have some sponsors that did help with equipment. So I had Borealis fat bikes. They gave me my bike frame and a few of the components for that. Shimano gave me the drivetrain, the brakes, the components for the bike. And then I got a handlebar and a seat post and a few things from Giant. DHL, they actually paid for the shipping from my bike and my equipment all the way to Punta Arenas, and then they also paid to get it shipped back. I had really cool sponsor, the sat phone store. They provided me with two satellite phones, two extra batteries for those phones, and a device that made it so that I could hook it up to the satellite phones. I could Wi-Fi connect my iPod and my iPad. I could connect those to this little box that then connected to the phone and be able to send data through the satellite, through the Iridium satellites. So that was very, very helpful. And they gave me a whole bunch of minutes. I used all the minutes they gave me, and then they gave me more. I used up those, and then they gave me more. So they were very generous, very good. The Ready store was pretty cool. They gave me all the food that I needed. So they gave me a lot of freeze-dried food and most of the food that I used. I did have some food that I bought with my bike store food, that I bought some bike specific type or kind of foods that you could get for biking. So I did get a few of that, but all my dinners and my drinks and all of that I got through the Ready store. Skins protective gear, they gave me some bags to mount on my bike to be able to carry things, and then they also gave me some hand guards that would go around the handlebars and protect my hands from the wind, and so that was very nice. Pearl Izumi gave me my base layer clothes, some socks, a coat that I used while cycling, and so they gave me a fair amount of clothing that I used, and so that was really cool. Expedo donated the pedals for my bike. There's Bear River Outfitters. They couldn't afford to just give me stuff, so what they did is they gave me a really good discount on the tent I used. I used a Heidelberg tent, nice tent. It's the tent that most people use in Antarctica. And they also gave me a discount on some really nice down mittens that I could put over my gloves. Hydroflask provided me with a few hydroflasks that I used to carry water and hot chocolate and sports drinks that I would in the morning boil the water, and then I would make hot chocolate or sports drink in the flask, and it's kind of cool. It was really nice because it kept the water the hot chocolate and stuff hot most of the day. It would stay hot until it started getting down towards the bottom of the flask. And when I get down to the bottom of the flask, then it would start getting cool. And so at the end of the day, I was drinking cold hot chocolate or cold sports drinks, but it never froze. And so at 40 below, all day out in 40 below temperatures, that was actually pretty cool. Tifosi gave me a couple pairs of sunglasses that I used to keep my eyes to protect my eyes. And Canada Goose was really good. They gave me a really nice expedition parka that really was a lifesaver, because during the time I was biking, I would actually usually be working so hard that I would be drenched in sweat. And that's a bad thing, a really bad thing in Antarctica. It can literally kill you. And so it meant that when I was biking, I would wear, this is the coat I was wearing most of the time while I was biking. So I'd have this and then a base layer underneath. But then as it got colder, I would start adding a few more layers in. But basically I was this coat, and then I would unzip it to try to keep from getting too hot from sweating. But you also had, it was really strong winds coming out of the north that would blow against me. So if I opened up too much, then I would get too cold. I could get frostbite, even though I was too hot. I could frostbite my chest and stuff. I also have vents in my jacket here, and I had vents in my pants that I could open. And so the Canada Goose parka was way too hot to wear while I was riding. But the consequence of the problem is with the bike, in order to stay upright, you have to go a minimum speed. There's a minimum speed before, if you go below, you just tip over. And so I had to go a minimum speed to go and to stay upright. And that work was so hard that I would just get drenched in sweat, which meant that pretty much all day long, I had to keep that effort up to stay warm enough. And then when I'd stop to set up my tent, the very first thing I'd do is I'd take my Canada Goose parka out of my sled, and I'd put that on, and that would keep me warm enough to be able to set up the tent and get in the tent. And then the sun hitting the tent would keep the tent warm enough that I didn't have to worry. Once I got inside the tent, I could undress, and it was actually fairly warm inside the tent. I mean, that Heidelberg tent was awesome. So Canada Goose gave me the parka. They gave me a really nice pair of down gloves. They gave me a nice buff to be able to go pull over my ears or down around my neck, and that adjustable, put it on top of my head. And so that was really nice. And so Canada Goose was really good to me. And so that helped reduce the costs, my total overall cost, because that provided a lot of the gear I need. It was actually fairly easy to get companies to provide me gear, but nobody really wants to supply just cold cash. And so I had to pay for that for myself. So if you put it all together, the expedition cost more than 80, somewhere between $80,000 and $100,000 for the expedition was the cash cost that I had to put in it. And that cash came almost all of that came from me taking a loan against my house. And to this day, I'm still paying off that loan. 5 years later, I'm still paying for the loan that I took out to be able to do this. So it was expensive, but Antarctica is, it's an amazing place, and I have no regrets. It was definitely worth it. And to be able to go to Antarctica and do, see that, where something that not very many people get. And then to add on top of that, to be able to be the first to bike to the South Pole is just an amazing opportunity for me that I'm really grateful for. I spent most of the day putting everything into Ziploc bags. I initially wanted to vacuum pack everything, but the vacuum packer did not fit in my luggage.
After all day of repacking everything, there's, and then underneath here,
hopefully this turns out better because the Ziploc bags allow me to reseal stuff. I met Doug Stoop, who did an ice bike expedition over 10 years ago. He is working on an expedition by Toyota truck. Overall, it was a great day, making great progress towards the start of biking.
In the next episode, I meet the missionaries, help the bishop make a nativity set, and actually fly to Antarctica.
Here is the story in his own words. My life changed forever the day my doctor told me if I didn't alter my lifestyle, I would likely die. I got serious about exercise and fell in love with biking. I became obsessed with the idea of biking to the South Pole. And before I knew it, I was setting off on my epic adventure. The trek lasted almost 2 months, and despite almost running out of food, I managed to keep my cool and achieve my dream. When it comes to outrageous bike expeditions, I'm definitely in pole position. Now, one of them is the only person in the world to bike to the South Pole, and the only person who is sworn to tell the truth.